Hi everyone, and welcome to part 1 of building and configuring your own Linux NAS. In this episode, I will cover the hardware part and base OS installation of my journey to a custom Linux-based NAS. As you might have guessed, in part 2, I will focus more on the software part. Let's start by having a look at the hardware requirements. As I would like to install the NAS in my utilities closet, I'd prefer it to be rather small and not too noisy. Since the device will be on 24/7, a low power consumption is a must. For the storage itself, I plan to use 2 3.5-inch SATA disks. Regarding external connectivity, USB version 3 would be nice for external backup. And of course, since we want our storage to be network attached, gigabit Ethernet must be present. After some research, I quickly discovered that a refurbished small form factor PC would hit most of these requirements. Only having enough space and SATA connections for 2 3.5-inch disks was slightly more difficult. Ultimately, I ended up with a ThinkCenter M91p, which has both a 3.5-inch disk and hosts a 5.25-inch DVD drive. This one I can easily replace by a mounting frame that allows additional space for 1 3.5-inch disk and an additional 2 2.5-inch disks or SSDs. At this point, you might start to wonder why I put this 2-bay NAS also in the video. Well, the new system is supposed to replace this one, and let's have a look at why I would like to have a replacement for it. This real network-attached storage device, if you can call it that way, has been serving me for the last 6 years. Although I had to replace the bundled operating system with Arch Linux in order to support SMBV2, I was still pretty happy with the device. Recently, I was struggling more and more with the lack of disk space, as in the past, I equipped the NAS with 2 1-terabyte disks in a RAID mirror. Those disks were regular desktop disks, so never designed for 24/7 continuous operation. And although they were still working fine, turns out they were over 9 years old, so really time to get them replaced if I want to keep my data safe. Let's have a quick look at the hardware before we make any changes. On the front side, we can see only the tray of the 5.25-inch DVD drive, making us think it's a slim drive, but fortunately that's not the case. Other than that, we can also see a few USB ports and a power button. On the back of the case, we see from left to right the power connector, serial port, VGA, display port, 6 USB 3 ports and the Ethernet connection, audio connection and also a second serial port. The blue latch can be used to open up the case. After we open the case, we can see the DVD drive, which is indeed a full 5.25-inch model, a 3.5-inch hard disk, 4 DDR3 memory slots, the CPU, and some expansion slots. We can easily remove the hard disk and then disconnect it. As you will see through the video, most of the components can be removed without any tools. Now that we remove the hard drive, we can easily lift up the DVD drive tray and disconnect it as well. This gives us space to have a closer look at the main board, where we can see the 4 SATA connections and the 4 memory slots. Now that we know what's inside the box, let's have a look at the components which we will replace. First off, we have the 120GB SSD, which I recovered from another system, 4x4GB of RAM to upgrade the system to a total of 16GB, power splitters and SATA data cables, and last but not least, 2 4-terabyte Western Digital Red Plus hard disks. To be able to fit all of this in the case, I will use a mounting bracket as I mentioned before. The mounting bracket should be completely toolless, although it came with a bunch of screws in the box. As you can see, this is the size of a 5.25-inch DVD drive and allows us to insert 2 2.5-inch and 1 3.5-inch disks in the same space. Again, without tools, we can easily remove the DVD drive. As you can see, it has a metal bracket on the side, and we need to reuse that on our disk mounting frame to be able to install it. Once we have moved the metal bracket from the DVD drive to the mounting frame, we can start by installing the disks. I'll start with the SSD, which goes on top and slides right in. Next, we can put the first 4 TB hard disk on the bottom. For the second hard disk, we'll use the plastic blue frame, but first we need to remove the original 500 gig hard drive that came with the box. Once we got it out, we can install our second 4 TB drive in the same plastic frame. Before we can reinsert the disks, we first need to take care of the memory while we have access to the slots. I'll first remove the existing module which came with the box and then replace it with the 4 new modules. As you can see, the memory slots are color-coded. That means we have support for dual-channel memory. If you have only 2 modules to install, you better populate one per channel for optimal performance. Since we have 4 modules, we can just populate all of the slots on the board. Another preparation step which we need to take is to make sure we have enough power connections, and we can do that easily by splitting the existing ones. Next, we can connect the SATA cables to the motherboard. Finally, we can install our disks in the system. The mounting frame simply slides into the tray where the DVD drive was, and once it's in place, we can connect the power and SATA data connections. Once we are done, we can just click the tray back into place. We just need to make sure we're not obstructing any cables. Next, we can take our second disk, which we installed in the frame before, connect power and data, and then install it back into the case. At this point, all our hardware modifications are done, and we can close the case. Taking a look on the outside, we can see that the mounting frame fits in pretty well and has a clean look. Now that we are done with the hardware modifications, it's time for the moment of truth. I connected the box to a screen and keyboard, and let's see if the machine boots and we can enter the BIOS. At first glance, everything seems to be working as expected. Let's have a look at the system summary to see if the system detects all the components we installed or changed. We can see that the machine detected our 16 gigs of RAM, our 2 4 TB disks, and the SSD. That's nice. We've came to the final part of the video. I've inserted a bootable USB drive that contains a Debian installation, and let's see if we can boot from it. That seemed to have worked fine, so let's have a quick walkthrough through the installation. First, we need to choose our language and region. After that, we can configure the root password and add a user account. Next up in the installation is to partition the disks. At this point, I will only partition the SSD, as I will use that for my Debian installation. Part 2 of this video will cover the initialization of the 2 4 TB disks which are in the system, which will host the data. For the SSD, I chose to use a 1 GB boot partition, a 4 GB swap area, and use all the rest of the space as the root file system. Once the base system is installed, we can choose optional packages, which I keep to a minimum as this will be a simple server without any GUI. Last step in the installation is to choose where to install the bootloader. After that, the system reboots. And we can see it boots up nicely up to the Linux CLI. This concludes the hardware and Linux OS installation. Stay tuned for the next part where I will have a deeper look into the software configuration of the NAS and we'll look into how we can optimize the power consumption of this device. Thanks a lot for watching this video. If you liked it, please put a thumbs up, and if you're interested in this or similar content, don't hesitate to subscribe to my channel. I also have a Linux-related blog, jensd.be, for which I provided a link in the description. Thank you, and I'm looking forward to see you back here soon.